So now let's start, okay. So everybody knows crowdsourcing. I think probably we need a very little introduction in crowdsourcing. Actually, crowdsourcing has a long history. If you think about the best example everybody knows could be Wikipedia, right? You think about Wikipedia was not done by one person, by a very large crowd, okay? And it has been keep updating, revision by the huge cloud. Even every entry could be done by many, many partners. Okay? We know this is a very big effort. And actually, even before that, for example, in 1970s, in Paris, they get a call for getting the pictures in Paris. They say, this is Paris in 1970. So they call it the hundreds of thousands of different pictures from all over in Paris in that year. Then finally they selected almost like a gallery collection. That's crowdsourcing, right? So crowdsourcing has a long history. When it really started calling this name, I probably should trace back to 2005. People actually really formally call this one as crowdsourcing. It's a one generate huge amount of data by a very large crowd, okay? Those large crowd could be, known, could be unknown, or even could be the sensor data. Like you can get sensor from all the different places on traffic, on weather. You can collect a huge amount of data. That data we can call crowdsourced data. Okay. So crowdsourcing, of course, is very valuable. It's very useful. But the problem also got a problem is, how do you trust this crowdsource? Because the crowdsource is from anywhere. You don't need a certificate. You do not need to get a first pass exam before you can do ground. Okay? And you will have very high quality data with some low quality data mixed up. Okay? You will contain errors. You contain values. But also you may have lots of different mistakes and time changing, okay? Some old things, you get into a new one, things are changing, maybe many even reliable sources. If you do not consider the time, consider the condition, it also could be wrong. Okay? So the problem becomes who will, guard the quality of the traffic. Okay? Of course you can say, oh, there will be like a Wikipedia, maybe there's somebody who can keep checking the quality. Remember, you have the large scale, get hundreds of thousands. If you do not have an automated mechanism, you try to guard the quality of the crowd, it will become very difficult. So we understand this. So the very important thing is whether data mining people, the KDD people, can make good contribution to this crowdsourcing. So we can develop mechanisms or algorithms automatically guard the quality of the crowdsource. Finally, when we integrate all the different kinds of data from different sources, we ensure the very high quality of the integrated data. So that's why data mining will play a very important role in crowdsourcing. So now we get down to the crowdsourcing, a little detail, okay? The crowdsourcing actually can be partitioned or categorized in many different ways, okay? But we basically categorize in the way called passive crowdsourcing and active crowdsourcing. What is passive crowdsourcing? Passive crowdsourcing means people generate data all around, okay? They are not responding to your particular request. Thinking about, for example, there are lots of medical health data. Actually, I believe Wei Fan later is going to show some medical, those kind of crowd, which is very interesting. You probably see you got a problem. You want to check the web. The web may have a very large crowd discussing this particular disease. Okay. They discuss not respond to your request. They have problem. They sustain, some kind of a treatment. Finally they got recovered or get worse. They start, putting their experience or complaints on the web. They hope other people can learn something. So this, we call this one, is passive crowd. And also, you even in Facebook and Twitter, people actively, for example, you say, this morning I'm going to downtown San Francisco, I got a traffic jam. You probably want to say, oh, which road I got a jam? Okay. So you put down there, of course, you hope you will benefit somebody. Okay. And somebody will benefit you as well. So that's basically the function of the crowd is, you know, the real-time traffic watch actually was done by a crowd. So this is a passive crowdsourcing. Then passive crowdsourcing, how we can define it, how we can see what is exactly passive sourcing. That means the users and data sources, they are shared. But they share on their own because you generate data just based on you hope you will contribute to the information world, okay? Contribute to this big data, you know, where somebody will put in use. So this is passive. The goal actually is other people, other algorithms will extract and integrate such information. For example, you may get some Google traffic. Okay, the people acting in Google traffic may integrate the traffic situation from many different sources, finally give you, say, this part is jam, this part is green. Okay. So this is a passive crowdsourcing. Passive, if you think in a graphic way, you can think is there are hundreds or thousands of users. Okay. They contribute information on the web or somewhere, okay, on a general common platform. With this platform, the algorithm, the system can extract data from many, many users, you know, putting information on the web. Then they integrate this piece of information, many pieces, they integrate together. Of course, there must be some smart algorithm try to say, oh, finally I get what is really happening. That means you want to filter those data, integrate those data, try to find the true information, okay? So that information will be put on the web as a little authoritative, you know, information people can use. Okay. This is a typical way of passive crowdsourcing. Now we look at active crowdsourcing. Active crowdsourcing, for example, you probably heard Amazon has a Mechanical Turk, there's Crowdflower, there are lots of different websites. What they do is they quite often they post queries, they want you to answer something, okay? For example, it could be there's a traffic jam. They may post to say, anybody can say what's happening, or which part is really jammed, or whether it's a car crash. So you want to, you know, avoid this road, or even go down to a detour automatically, okay? So those kind of things, people actually respond, that could be crowd. A typical example could be, you can see there are two pictures, okay? They put it down there and say, whether these two pictures actually is the same person, okay? So then you got lots of people who may give you answer in a different way. So some people say, oh, these are exactly the same. The other guy said, no, they look similar, but they are different ones. Or you say, maybe, okay? So there are many, many different answers. But once you get this crowd, you may have an algorithm. You say, I integrate them, I get a vote. You know, maybe finally the vote, majority of people say they are exactly the same, that must be the same person. So then they can win, okay? Or they maybe say they look similar, but the other guy is just an actor, you know, like you could see even on the TV. Some people say, oh, this is an actor of the Hillary or Trump. Right, so because you watch it, it looks like, but it's different. Okay. So these are the ones you actually can say the crowd can make good judgment. Of course, it also can make wrong judgment. That's exactly why we want to see whether the majority voting is definitely right, or we have some better way to judge the quality. Okay. So then we look at the crowdsourcing, active crowdsourcing, what is the real characteristics, okay? The characteristic is some people put a request, okay? Then we have a large crowd to do the job, okay? To do the crowdsourcing. you can think about a Mechanical Turk can be a very interesting one, because you can say, I send some request, okay? The other people actually give back, say whether it's yes or no, or whether, you know, they can even answer in a more complicated way. But you need a design to make sure you will not be bogged down by various kinds of strange answers. That means you want the answer to be crisp, to be understandable, actually understandable by the algorithms, so you can automatically make judgment. Okay. So that's active crowdsourcing. Active crowdsourcing, if you look at the picture, graphic picture, you can say user, the system like Crowdflower or Mechanical Turk. They send a query to a lot of people, say, you do it for me, okay? Of course, why they do it for you, there are many different reasons. You can push a cash reward, or you can put a competition, okay? Or you can say, just do some favor for me, okay? You get some reputation, or some kind of psychological reward, okay? Whatever, you give some motivation to the crowd will respond. So that's the way you send a query, you send a request, you finally integrate all the answers back. So you will say what it really is. Okay. So that's the crowdsourcing, I think you heard know. You can see there are two big categories according to this lecture. Okay. Now we look at the problem of data fusion or data integration. Because you got a crowd, you get many different answers for the same questions. Okay? So which one is right? Okay. Of course, the easiest one is the majority voting. Okay? The easiest one says, okay, I got so many people coming back and saying the answer. If some answer got a majority, I will believe this one is right. Okay, I will put it up. That's a very popular method. Of course, you probably see some easy question, you can do that. But some tricky question, even majority one could be wrong, okay? Some minority could be right. How could you just blindly trust the majority? Okay. So that's another one. Another way, of course, is average. You can get statistics. You can say, oh, how many people, you know, like, you probably know that even for the current, like, a presidential election, there are lots of polls. You say, oh, how many people, youngsters, vote, pro Hillary, how many people pro for, you know, Trump or something. You probably get a lot of averaging according to different conditions, right? But, you know, there's one problem if you're just thinking about doing crowding this way, because you want to do high quality job, but if you also know not every majority voting is 100% trustable. So if we do not, you know, thinking about source reliability, actually if you were a teacher, you probably know, sometimes you give a test, a tough test, tough question in your exam. Actually, you may see the majority of students may do wrong. There could be a few very, very good ones, very smart ones. They were not tricked by your question, they did it right, okay? If you do majority voting, The smart student can get punished. The people who did wrong, you can get a scores. Get a credit. That's not fair, right? We know that. Especially the question becomes more difficult. You want to think about who are very smart or who are very careful. So that means you are trusting somebody who are so smart, so careful. They can do things right. Even the majority can do wrong. Okay. That means you actually will not ignore the source reliability. Actually, even myself, sometimes I give a tough exam, but I don't want to spend time to give all the answers. I told TA, I said, you know who are the very smart students. You pick up the very smart one. Those always got almost 4.0. You first check their answer, you work out the answer, you send back to me, rather than you just check the majority. Random sampling doesn't work. Okay. So they actually know that. They always pick up the very best students and check it. If they vote for something, they probably trust them all, right? So this is a source reliability problem. Okay. So So that means, but how do you know source reliability? On the cloud, it's not like you already got a record, this guy is an A-plus student all the time. Okay, you trust this guy. Okay. You don't know. The large cloud, you don't know. How do you work out the source reliability? Okay. So that these are very interesting questions. Okay. Now we get into the problem from another angle is truth discovery. Truth discovery means suppose you got lots of people give you the answer. Okay. Which one is exactly true? Do you have any principle to guard against it? Okay. Some people easily say, oh, training. I got something, you know, some people give me labor, or I give some labor, I do the training. Okay. Remember, once you get a so big crowd with so many variety and questions, you train on this question, somebody answer right. Doesn't mean he doesn't answer right for the other questions. So the training, you get, you know, one or two questions, like a small class, you get the positive and negative, you can train it. But if you have hundreds, thousands of problems, okay, this labor may not be correlated with the other labor. So the simple training, you know, purely supervised way may not work. Okay. So actually I got early days, I got one PhD student, Xiaoxing Yin. He actually came back from summer intern. You know, the students, PhDs, they go to different companies in the summer, they do some very interesting research work, they come back. The student come back with a tough problem. He said his boss gave him a problem. He said, on the web, there are so many things. For one thing, there's so many people say different things, okay? Without anybody telling you which one is right. Can you figure out? Can you work out an algorithm to tell which one is right? Okay. He thought about it. He said, this is impossible. Okay, we have to get 100,000 of different things. And people say all different things. There's no training labor. And training labor is even not interrelated. How can I say? He thought for a week. He said, I cannot solve this problem. You better give me a simple one. So he finally did a brilliant intern, but he brought the problem back. Okay. So now, actually, this is one of the major principles he finally worked out. You probably can see. We know we trust more reliable sources. Okay. But how do you know which source is more reliable? Okay. So he worked out this principle is we get multiple conflicting information about the same sets of objects provided by different information sources. And we want to know which information is right or is reliable, and which source, which information provider is more reliable. Okay, you want to know both. Okay. Now, we work out a general principle. If you read it, you probably will buy it. Okay. Basically, say you got trustable information, you got reliable sources, or you do not know their trustability or reliability. Okay. Now you can work out these two sentences, the two assertions. Remember, these two are mutually independent, They rely on each other if you want one help the other. Okay. The first one called a source is reliable if it provides many pieces of true information. Okay, that's exactly like an A-plus student. Why you trust this A-plus student? Because in the past, in so many long history, he always, you know, scored very right, very on the top. Every course he got A-pluses, you probably recruit him into your class, you trust him more. Why? Just because this student is reliable, because this student provided many pieces of trustable information, right? Now you look at the other side. You say a piece of information is likely to be true. It is provided by many reliable sources. That's exactly what I told my DAs. I say, oh, you grab, you know, a group of A-plus students. Then you check whether they are consistent, that they agree with this answer. Okay, if all these A-plus students agree on this answer, likely this answer should be the right one. You can see that's a very simple principle, common sense. But these two pieces of common sense can mutually enhance each other. Because at the very beginning, you do not even know which one is right, right? But whether these two can mutually enhance each other in a loop, we'll see. Now we look at a crowdsource information. Okay. So what? How we want to aggregate or integrate all these crowdsources? Okay. And of course, the crowdsource, in many cases, you may get different answers. But you, once they disagree, how we integrate them together, we can use truth finding. Okay. So you probably can see the crowdsourcing and truth finding. You can think it's a coin on the two different facets, different things, right? Because you can think about the truth discovery can help crowdsourcing because you get many different, you know, different conflicting answers. You want to judge which one is right. And the truth discovery definitely can, you know, to a certain extent, even if it was originally not designed for crowdsourcing. You are judging from different information sources, that's automatically become crowdsourcing problem, right? So they have a common goal. They may share some common methods as well. Then we look at the principles. I think this principle, we said the data is reliable or source is reliable. These two principles, actually they mutually enhance each other. Actually it works for truth discovery, works for crowdsourcing as well. So you probably can see this crowdsourcing and truth discovery really, really tightly linked together. The interesting thing was originally when truth discovery started, it was more in the data mining community, or some in the database community they do this. The crowdsourcing actually community start from the different angle, they also try to solve this problem. So you finally can see the data mining community can really help crowdsourcing community to ensure the high quality of the integration of the crowdsource. Okay. So that's why we probably can see, of course, in this lecture, we're going to see the different subtle differences. We're going to resolve them as well. Okay. So then we look at the data collection, data generation. You probably can think about a truth discovery. Because we choose discovery is you got the data, you get the data from many different sources, you collect them, you try to resolve them. This is more like a passive crowdsourcing. Okay. The crowdsourcing, the active part means you can control what question to ask, what question you can collect. Okay. For example, if you ask ambiguous questions, okay, you cannot blame the crowdsourcing give you very ambiguous, you know, answers. To make your truth finding much more difficult. You probably know sometimes the people doing the poll. Okay, even I remember, you know, when some country doing those, you know, the big poll, everybody votes whether split or not split or something. They make the question still very hard for people to parse and complete sense. Okay, the people who want to split, they work out the question in so subtle way. The people read it, they may answer, even they do not want to split, they may answer in the wrong way. Okay. So that's actually the crowdsourcing. Sometimes you have to think about it. If you want to get an ambiguous answer, you have to design a question the way people can answer it in a very clear way. Okay. That's what crowdsourcing will do. The truth finding usually is just based on statement, you collect them, you finally figure out what it is. Okay. So you can see one is a passive, you can think that choose discovery most and discovery passive crowdsourcing. Okay. The real crowdsource, like mechanical theory, crowdflowers, or even people are doing all those kind of voting, you get questions, you can design questions. Right.
That's great, right? Okay.
Now we look at the crowdsourcing, the choose discovery part. I probably should need to go a little faster because. But anyway, let me get into this. The data format, the for truth discovery, data is collected data from the open domain. So you cannot define the data, what kind of types, what kind of ranges. But crowdsourcing, you do have lots of flexibility your control to design the question, design the data, you collect the data, could be in a better structured way. Okay. So that means one is a more open space, the other is more closed space. Okay. Let's look at the general philosophy for different methodologies, because the truth discovery and crowdsourcing has been the research done so far. There are so many very fancy methods already created. Okay. We can basically say one is more using statistic modeling, okay, we call it statistic way. Inside this, there's a one particular line of work called generative models. That means you use some probabilistic graphic model, you use some generative modeling approach to model the truth. Okay. Another one is optimization method. That means you try to think about your true answer and the other answer, there's a distance. Okay. You try to minimize the distance, you finally be closer to the true answer. Okay. So let's first discuss the statistic method. The statistic method is try to find the conditional probability of a claim being true, okay? And the source could be from many different sources, different workers, or different, websites or something, okay? So inside this, there's a one particular influential method called generative model. The general philosophy is, you see something, you can observe. Those are the observed data. And of course, you observe the sources. You see the source, you see the observation, the claims. Okay. But you assume these links, there are some hidden generative process underneath. No, you can generate according to a typical Bayesian model or some probabilistic modeling approach, you can generate it. Then you figure out what should be the parameter, what should be underlying mechanisms generate this. Okay. Then we will be able to figure out what should be the truth. Okay. So that means you are reasoning on two sides. One is source reliability, the other is the truth of the fact or the statement. So there are many, many methods developed on the generative model. For example, there were called GTM. It's a generative, you can think about truth model. That one actually was done by Bo Zhao. He is going to introduce his approach. And before he joined Microsoft Research in his PhD, actually was working on GTM and LTM. G means the Gaussian, okay? It's using Gaussian model to do the truth modeling. LTM is latent truth model. Latent means it actually underneath there's some mechanism. You really use generative model to get it. Okay. Then there are other methods. I think later, Professor Jing Gao, they are going to introduce many more. I probably will not get into detail anyway. So let's get into this optimization model. What is optimization model? Optimization model is you try to minimize or maximize. Of course, it depends on which goal you want to optimize. You get an objective function. Okay. This function, this G as an objective function, actually was, you have two major parameters. One is W, one is V. One is a source reliability. You can think one is a state of facts, the statements. You want to get the reliability on these two parameters. Putting in into this object function, you want to minimize it to the distance to the real truth to be minimized. Okay. This one essentially is based on a lot of optimization, mathematical, this kind of optimization approach. You have some constraints, for example, these two, delta one, delta two, means you have some constraint function to make this source and the objects to following certain constraints. Under this constraint, for example, you have several assumptions. You may say these assumptions probability adding together should be one, okay, something like this. Okay. Then you can use this to optimize it. So now I will just introduce the first method called truth finder. This truth finder was done by Xiaoxing Yin. He now, I think, you know, he was in Microsoft Research after his PhD in UIC, and later joined, you know, like Google. You know, I'm not sure exactly where he is now because they keep changing companies. But anyway, the interesting thing is he brought that question back, the intern question back. The intern question was, on the web, there are so many different sources. Okay. They claim something conflicting. Without anybody training you, can you find which piece of information is right? That looks very tough problem. He brought the question back to me. He said, I thought for a week, I cannot get any answer. I came back, I brought this question back, maybe it's a good research problem. Then my first response is, you have to find some real data, which really conflict each other we can analyze. And after a few days, he came back and very excited, told me he found some answer. It's a surprisingly nice example. Is there that time in that 2007, okay, around that time, you probably still see Barnes Noble, Powers book, there are so many booksellers on the web, okay? They sell lots of books. Of course, now probably not that many, okay? You probably buy books mostly from Amazon or some people from Barnes Noble. You won't see hundreds of thousands of the bookstores. Okay? That time you do see a lot. Okay? Once you see a lot, he wants to test every bookseller, put the information is right, whether they conflict each other. You probably say, oh, selling book, how people can conflict in the information. Actually, he found this very interesting. He grabbed one book, the book called Rapid Contextual Design. Of course, it's not as well-known book like, you know, some book everybody, you know, cites. He wants to find the authors. To his own surprise, he found those different bookstores. They give the authors different. And you know, a book only can, there's only one piece of information is right, who wrote this book. And he found that actually they were wrong. They are different. And that actually becomes a very good problem. Which piece of right? Okay, because the bookseller providing conflicting information. Which piece is right? And of course, he did it since he downloaded from Amazon.com, he looked the images and enlarged it and finally find only A1 books provided 100% right information. There are three authors, 100% right. Okay. Even Barnes Noble got it wrong. What's wrong? After the second author, the second name was gone. Okay. And if you look at it, for example, Cornwall books, they all link those, this becomes Spanish or something, they link the first name, last name, all become the last name, right? So there are lots of very strange, you know, information on the web. The problem is, if you do not know it, you do not check Amazon.com, this picture on the book, how could you judge which piece is right? Okay. So that becomes an immediate real problem in the real world. Okay. Then we start discussing what should be the answer, how we can figure out which book author is 100% right. The interesting thing is, he worked out a very interesting answer by just linking these into a graph. The graph is one side is website, like Barnes Noble, you know, Powers book, all these other websites, W1, W2, W3. Okay. The other one is a book, that's a real book, that's a one book, is object one. Another book is object two. You get a lot of books, you get hundreds of books, you can link that way. And then they start conflicting. For example, you look at object one. There's a W1 provided facts, F1, say this is the author. Okay. W2 provided F2, say that's your author. Okay. Now you can link them as a graph. Can you figure out, without anybody telling you what's the trick, can you figure out, just based on the graph, you almost can very reliably to say which one is more trustful, which W is more trustful, which F, the claim, is correct. Can you do that? that immediately become an intelligent, you know, question answering problem. Okay. Then before he tried to work out an algorithm to make it right, he got several observations. Okay. He put these observations down. The first thing is, this question must have a unique right answer. Okay, just thinking about it, who was the author of the book? There must be something, it's the truth, okay? It's not floating, okay? The second, that means we actually were not trying to judge like a Republican claim or Democrat claim in those things, because it's very hard to judge which one is right, sometimes in a so ambiguous way. Both could be right, just based on different position, different conditions, right? So that's actually become very tricky. We use a simple one that everybody can judge this is right, only one truth, okay? The second one is sometimes you make the answer slightly different, actually they are all right. For example, if you say the author is Jennifer Widow, the other you say Jadal Widow, okay? Both are right, but even they look different, but just the one is more detailed. Okay? So we do not think these are conflicting. Then we get these three and four, you probably can say. The three said the false facts of different websites are less likely to be the same or similar. What does this mean? This means if you make something wrong, you just think about the webs, the people writing who are the authors of books. You write it wrong in one way, the other guy write wrong in the other way. If you're wrong, very likely you're wrong in many different ways rather than you are all consistent. Think about that. Is that true? Actually, some people have a hard time to understand it. Why? I often give an example. So suppose we got three thieves, you know, who stole a bank. Okay. The police catch all the three thieves. Okay. You think how the police will handle it? Police want to find truth, right? You think the police will say, we have a panel discussion to see what happened? The police would not be so stupid, right? So they actually were isolating every thief. They challenging, question the thief down to the bottom. How the police finally for these three thieves, they can find what's really happening. Actually, the police actually have a common sense that if the thief wants to lie, these three thieves lie, you question them down to the detail, the three thieves very likely lie in a very strange, different way. Can hardly be consistent. Okay. If these three seem telling the truth, there will be a convergence. Okay. So you think this, if a thief wants to lie, they lie in many different ways, right? So that's the way police finding the truth. Okay. That's the way our algorithm can find truth, right? Then the fourth one becomes, say, the website provides mostly true facts for many objects, we're likely to provide true facts for these other objects. That means, if you really get a credibility on this website is so careful, make all these authors right, you probably trust this website more than the others, right? That's common sense, trustability problem. Now we got this. Now I probably just take this problem, challenging you to see whether you can work out the algorithm, okay? You probably can see that's exactly Xiaoxin's algorithm. At the very beginning, he just assumed every website has the equal trustability. Everybody is same. You can see the green bar, everybody has the equal length. That means I do not have bias on anything beforehand. Now we use those principles. You can look at this. What principle you can see? Of course, F1, F2 only got one link. People say, forget it. We see whether there are some, like police challenging the thieves. Thieves have something, you know, convergent. You look at F3, F4, they both provide information for object O2, but they conflict, okay? But F3 got three people provide the same thing. You could say, three people say F3. Then likely F3 could be right, because if they are wrong, they're wrong in exactly the same ways, they're rare. So you will say F3, I assume it's right. F4, I assume it's wrong. Then what do you do? If F3 you assume is right, F4 you assume is wrong, can you help us to judge F1 and F2. You think about it, okay? Actually, things become easier. Why? Because F3 is right, F4 is wrong. You say, who said F3, who said F4? Okay, now let's see. F3 was provided by W1, F4 provided by W2, okay? That's immediately you try to identify who is your A-plus student, who is your F student, okay? You can see, likely, this W1 could be your A-plus student. Likely, this W2 could be your C student, right? Because they provide this one, everybody said it's right, you said it wrong, okay? Likely, your credibility is reduced. Then, we judge F1, F2. Now it's become easier to judge, right? You judge F1, F2, you will say F1 likely will be right, F2 likely will be wrong. Of course, you may immediately challenge him and say, how can we be sure, okay? The problem is, we are not dealing with this tiny graph. We are dealing with thousands of websites, hundreds of thousands of objects, they all link together into this kind of graphs. The probability, the chance to be very wrong after these many iterations, every chance to still be wrong is very small. Think about this. That's the judgment, because at the very beginning, you are careful, you just give more credit to those things that really you are pretty sure is right. You can see that's what he did. He actually treat this one as very much like a web, page ranking, this kind of style. At the very beginning, everybody ranked the same, okay? Now we start competing. And how we compete each other, you probably can see. You use these two formulas. One, this W is on the website reliability. Then this F is on your fact trustability. Fact is, possible truth. You actually can see these two, you use this function. One said the trustability of the website or the information provider is the average on what he provided more reliable information. That means how many pieces of information he provided right, how many pieces he provided wrong. But he even do not know which one is right, which one is wrong. How do you do that? You go back to the F. You compute F based on the trustability who provides this information. At the very beginning, you do not know anything, but you start with a little like a kind of a voting. You can think in that way, the convergence. Then you turn back and forth, many wrongs. Once it becomes stable, you get very, very good, trustability, right? That's what he did. The interesting thing is he actually tested his method by taking those many different websites to check all these things. He worked out a great data set. Actually, later many people used his data set. Of course, I would say though some information provider, those books that are already gone, they're already bankrupt. Okay. But whatever the information, the data set he seized in 2007, still alive now, then people still use it. Okay. So you probably can see what he did is he compared with Barnes Noble. Why he compares Barnes Noble? Just because for a bookseller at that time, 2007, Google actually ranked Barnes Noble number one. And his philosophy is, if I can beat number one, I basically prove my method actually is good because I do not rely on anything, I just rely on my algorithm. Okay. He collected many websites, like 20 or 30 websites, different information providers. And he finally found, for 100 randomly sampled books, of course he sampled many times, random sampled books, you can see, Choose Finder, his algorithm provided 85 correct answers, Barnes Noble provided 64, okay? He missed, for missing author, he got 2, Barnes Noble got 4. You look at every entry, he actually got far better than Barnes Noble. That's a paper he published in 2007, shows his algorithm really works because he knows nothing about the truth. He did not even go back to check the Amazon pictures anymore. He just say, there are so many information providers, many of them could be wrong, but finally I could be right. Okay, so you can see that's the power of truth finding. So this algorithm since its publication got many, many citations just because they think this is a pretty smart algorithm. Now we get into another stage. Dr. Bo Zhao is going to present.
If you think about the book authors, they actually have multiple authors, right? So if you really want to find the truth that contains the true list of authors, one way, as Xiaoxin's approach, is basically treat each fact as an author list. But another way to think about this problem is if we can segment the author list into several individual authors and try to estimate each individual author is true or not, then we can probably potentially do better. But that somehow needs to have a new definition of the truth-finding problem, because previously we all assumed there's only one truth for each object, like a book, there's only one true author list. But now if you think about it with segment author list, then that means we'll have potentially have multiple true authors, right? So in this approach, we basically, the problem definition is that multiple facts can be true for each entity. Like one book may have two plus more authors, one movie may have like many actor, actress, or directors. And if you think about it, this kind of data is very common on the web, right? So like typically we want to integrate data. Many often, like they have actually multiple true attributes for the same object. Then the problem becomes, the source can, the same can make multiple claims, but entities, like the source can claim three authors, can have one author. And then the problem becomes, if you look at the data, actually it's much more common for a source to miss some true attributes. Because like a lot of websites just say, oh, we just up to the first author. A lot of movie websites only output the leading actor or actress for a movie. So this kind of error is like this false negative error, right? So it's very common. On the other side, the other type of error is really giving you wrong authors or wrong actors, actress about movies. That type of error is less common. But if you think about this, there are really two types of errors. So if this is a table, so basically from previous slides you see that for a book we basically treat each author list as a fact. Now let's say, how about we just segment the authors, right? So like for this data mining book, Professor Han and others are authors, let's segment those authors. And basically for each author, we can observe for a given source whether that source output that author, and also like we also know like whether this author is really true or false. Then we basically, after we model this way, we can have a generative model. So basically says, for a given book and for a given author, we kind of random, like we assign a latent label on the truth. And like it's a binary label, it could be one or zero, meaning it's a true or false. And each source can have two qualities in a sense. Like it's a false positive rate and sensitivity. Sensitivity means the probability that source output yes, given the truth is yes. And false positive rate means the probability of also outputting yes, given the truth is false. So this is typical how generative model works for each source. And we generate false positive rate. Here we basically use strong regularization because on the web data. So this also is slightly different from like binary labeling from crowdsourcing, where like the two source are two kind of source quality are kind of the same. But here, if you think about data integration and truth discovery on web, the false false positive rate are typically not that high compared with false negative rate. So basically, for each source, we can generate false positive rate with strong regularization from beta distribution, and we can also generate this sensitivity, which is kind of just recall from also a beta distribution. But here we can use uniform prior, indicating our prior belief that it's much more common for a source to miss some data. And for each fact, we can generate also from the truth from the prior truth probability, and then generate the truth label from the Bernoulli distribution. Then for each claim of fact, we basically can generate observation. So if this author is false, we can use the false positive rate to generate the observation. On the other hand, if this author is the fact is true, we use sensitivity to generate the observation. As we can see, like after we model the problem in a different way, and like we can pre-process the data and segment authors, we can achieve much higher quality compared with truth finding and voting. So, like F1 is almost 2 perfect. Then the next step, we want to talk about the optimization model. Generally speaking, so if we think about it, like there are multiple types of data. So in the previous approach, we kind of modeling the problem as a kind of each individual chooses Bernoulli, but we can also have other models to model real value truths, like you have price, you have like rating, we can use Gaussian distribution. But at high level, basically we can define a cost function, a loss function, about the measure the distance between the truth and the observation. And so basically, however, this is how this kind of optimization of the model works. We define a cost function. So we really want to estimate source quality and also choose to minimize this loss function. To solve this kind of problem, we can basically convert the primary problem to its dual form. We can use block coordinate descent or other kind of optimization approaches. And also, if each sub-problem is convex and smooth, then the convergence is also guaranteed. In this work, we have this CRH framework that is published in Figma. This is object function. So as we can see, with the function D really measures the distance between the truth and the observation. This can be any cost function you pick, like. For numerical data, you can pick Gaussian. For other categorical data, you can just pick yes or zero. So this is a generic framework. And the assumption is that the truth should be close to the observation from reliable sources. So how do we measure that? So basically, for source quality, we basically model it as a parameter W here. So it's a weight. That means at high level, if this observation comes from a reliable source, then we should give a high weight on the cost function. So it means it will produce much higher loss if the truth is deviated much from observation from more reliable source compared with less reliable source. So as we already mentioned, so basically loss function can be anything, and we can basically loss function output the high score when the observation deviates from the truth, and the low score to solve this, we also need to have some constraints, so otherwise the object function may go to infinity, and we need to do some regularization. For the inference part, it's kind of also similar to truth finding and other generative model. So we have two types of unknown parameter. One is the truth, the second is the source reliability. So basically we do this iteratively. First we just minimize weighted distance between the truth and the source of observation. This part will basically estimate the truth to minimize the cost functions. And then we can estimate the source reliability to also, with the same object function, just also minimize the object function to assign the best weights to each source. And I'm gonna talk about a bunch of methods. These methods traditionally come from the machine learning community. They're more focused on crowdsourcing. Actually, this paper was from 1979, so it's a pretty old paper, but it's kind of very similar to a lot of principles where the more recent approaches are working on. So, and this is also very strong baseline in the, when people do crowdsourcing in the traditional crowdsourcing community. So here, basically, that is like we ask the crowd to do multiple choice questions, and we have a fixed answer space, right? So then basically, we can have a confusion matrix of the workers' quality. Basically, the probability that J is the correct answer, but the worker answers L, so we model this probability as a pi JL, so this is the whole matrix. And we also have a probability to measure the random chosen function has the correct answer J. This is also a generative model, so to compute the likelihood, so basically when J is correct, so basically you have you basically take a product of all the source quality to generate the observation, and at high level, basically for a given correct answer, that part is one. So basically, you use all the probability sources given the truth is J, the output L to generate their output. So you can compute the likelihood, and then. But the problem is you don't really know the, this is the full likelihood, but you don't really know the truth, right? So you don't really know JI. To estimate, also you don't know the pi, which is the source quality. So a high level basically can use EM algorithm to iteratively maximize the likelihood. So it's also like basically EM and steps corresponding to optimizing the truth and optimizing the source quality.
How is this different from the
I think it's similar, yeah. Yeah. Also, like, if you look at all the extensions, so they have a lot of extensions. So in some EMLP paper, they have some navigation approaches. And in some NIPS, 14 have finding a good initial point, and I think in 2010, 2015, we adding instances can have feature vectors for instances, and we also have contra papers to using more Bayesian way put fire on workers, and in SDM we have some clustering on workers. And also, there are a bunch of theoretical analysis on the error bounds of this kind of approaches published in NIPS and some other workshops. Another work approach kind of extend that the previous approach by considering the image, like the quality, like difficulty of the problem. So the problem, particular problem this paper works on is for the image annotation task. So also the truth is kind of hidden, it's hidden variable. You generate observation, you have also have source quality labor accuracies, but also you have a parameter to control how difficult the task is. Then for the object function, basically they use logistic laws. Basically for workers accuracy and difficulty in the image, both take a factor in the how the likelihood is computed. So that means if the task is very ambitious or kind of difficult, you may want to like give less penalty if the worker makes a mistake. On the other hand, if the task is very easy, you would need to make more penalty to the worker. So that's the formulation here. So it's slightly different from the previous approach where they basically use multinomial distribution. Then we talk about we'll talk about the another optimization approach. This is published by Danny Zhou from Microsoft Research in 2012. This approach further extends the previous approaches. If you think about the previous approaches, there are many observations. One is for a given item. You really want to kind of trust the weighted sum of the majority. It's not really majority voting, but you want to kind of trust the weighted voting. Weights are resource quality. And on the like for each worker, you kind of assume that the worker's quality is consistent across all items. Those are the two major assumptions of those previous approaches. But now Danny comes and says, that may not be true. How about we give much more parameters? Let's assume each worker, each item has its own quality distribution. So so this basically is like pi ij. So it's like, we don't even assume it's consistent. Like we basically say for each worker I and item j, we can have a completely different distribution. As you might see, the problem here is that it dramatically increased the number of parameters. Then how can you even optimize this since it has so many parameters? So the answer is that you can put constraints. So for each item, you kind of really want to constrain your source reliability so that their sum for this item matches the observed answer. So that means like either you can just freely optimize your source quality, but on the item level, you take a sum, you should just match your observation, which is like basically you observe all these loads, they should match. And on the worker side, it's the same. So basically, although each worker and each item has their own distribution, but you take a sum on the row, it should match or observe the worker's operation. So and also here you have a kind of unknown parameter y, which is the label. So right, if you know the label, you compute the true quality of the worker, and it's at every level it should be the same as the distribution. So basically, this kind of give you more freedom in the sense that really each worker for some items, they can have a different kind of quality. This is a nice approach. So basically, to really make it work, you need to have these constraints. This becomes constraint optimization problem. And then for given these constraints, at first step, you really want to maximize the entropy of the pi parameters, like the source quality. Basically, assume that, you know, since we're picking all this distribution, let's make it as random as possible. Let's assume the worst case, what's the entropy of these distributions. This is one part of the object function. Then when you want to estimate the truth, which is y, you kind of want to reduce that entropy, right? So the maximum entropy part is the worst case of the source quality. And you want to pick the truth to minimize this worst case. So and this also corresponds to if you can check the paper for details. So basically, since you kind of maximize entropy, the entropy part of the distribution is kind of fixed. But then the rest part that you want to minimize is really the KR divergence between the observation and the truth. So basically, this object function also creates basically kind of equivalent to minimizing the KR divergence between the truth and the observation. Here's my part, and next step we will have Professor Jing to talk about passive processing.